J. Jermaine Bay of Lothian Moore's Pradium, Ante, Colorado. The acronym is AMPAC. I'm the Chief Judge of Consular Court. Today is Class 107. Class 107. What did we learn in Class 106? Well, we went over quite a few things, right? We talked about the Moors, how they were undermined by the Sultan, how the Moors were undermined by the United States of America, right? We talked about what took place in an alleged act of genocide in the year 1958 and in the year 1959, right? The United States of America and the Sultan of Morocco, being Mohammed V at the time, had a complicity, right? They were complicit in trying to undermine the Moors during that time of 1956, right? So in 1956, keep in mind that the Sultan proclaimed his independence, right? He had a Declaration of Independence. He signed what's called the Franco-Morocco Agreement, March 2nd, 1956, right? And shortly thereafter, the United States of America starts to negotiate with the King of the Kingdom of Morocco, right? Keeping in mind that the United States of America was already talking to the Sultan for at least 10 years before the Sultan declared his independence. So at the time, France was controlling the Empire of Morocco, and Mohammed V didn't like France still overseeing the Empire of Morocco. So the Sultan, right, Mohammed V, fought for his independence, right? So he declares his independence March 2nd, 1956, through an act where he wrote an agreement with France. France accepted that agreement. And from there, Mohammed V starts to get into complicity, right, to commit genocide against the Moors, right? And we'll learn more about that today. What else did we talk about in Class 106? Well, I started to show you what the good brother Barack H. Obama was trying to show the Moors in the year 2009 by talking about the Treaty of Tripoli of 1796, Article 11, right? And that Obama put his political willpower on the table early on in his political career. So we're talking about the year 2009. That was his first year in office, right? So Obama was trying to wake up the Moors, to let the Moors know they're not Moorish Americans, let the Moors know that they're not Americans. And the only reason why they're classified as Americans is because they've been naturalized as Americans, right? That the Moors are actually Moroccans according to treaties. So Barack H. Obama tried to help all the indigenous people of the land, right? So he goes after, he leaves Cairo, Egypt in 2009. Then he goes over and signs the Rights of Indigenous People in 2010, right? So he's trying to send all these subtle messages to the Moors. But for some reason, the Moors didn't catch on. The Moors didn't understand that Obama was trying to show us it's about the law. Well, what type of law? Moroccan law. But yet the Moors kept saying they were Moorish Americans. So therefore, after Barack H. Obama tried to help the Moors in 2009, he kind of walked away from it, right? Because he did his part. He pointed out the treaties, and after that, it was on the Moors to figure out what other legislative acts they needed. What is it that Barack Obama was hoping that the Moors would eventually establish? He was hoping that the Moors would draft what? A constitution. Barack H. Obama was in office from 2008 when he was president-elect. Then he swears in 2009. He leaves office in 2016, right? So he was in office for 8 years, and during 8 years, the Moorish Americans never took the time to understand statehood. 8 years straight. But yet the Moors kept talking about what Obama did for the Moors. But yet the Moors didn't understand fully what Obama actually did, right? So we lost a lot of time because Obama would have understood that the Moors were enacting, under what's called self-determination, their own uti possidetis constitutions in each of the colonized territories of the Empire of Morocco. So while Barack H. Obama was in office, he could have signed off on what? Public Law 856, right? Where the United States of America would have had to fully relinquish jurisdiction in the Empire of Morocco. But the only thing the Moors was talking about was the Pope. The Pope and the Pope and the Doctor's Discovery and the Pope. All types of distractions. Now, the Moors talk about Obama signed the rights to indigenous people in 2010, but yet the Moors never took the time to even understand the preamble or Article 1. They kept jumping to Article 6 to talk about nationality, but you've got to start at Article 1. Article 1 talked about what in the rights of indigenous people? It talked about the United Nations. The United Nations is where the Moors needed to go and study. Barack H. Obama was pointing this out when he talked about the Treaty of Tripoli was about Moroccan law. Treaties are about international law. Barack H. Obama then signs the rights of indigenous people to try to get the Moors' attention to go look at international law, to study the United Nations Charter. But did the Moors do that? No. They were too busy talking about Anna von Ritz and the letter that she wrote on behalf of, allegedly, for the Pope. The Moors love talking about the Pope. It's a distraction. We've delayed our own justice. And for some reason, we kept talking about Barack H. Obama, what he did for us. But at the same time, none of the Moorish American teachers took the time to go and read the charter out loud to the Moors. Instead, they kept reading about Anna von Ritz in the letter from the Pope to Obama. And Obama's sitting there like, oh, God, go read the treaties. Go study international law. Go read the charter. Go establish your states, Moors. And what did the Moors do instead? They delayed their justice because they were in fellowship instead of scholarship. And that's the truth. So today we'll continue on talking about international law. Today we'll continue to talk about what Obama tried to point out, which was that the Moors needed to establish and draft constitutions in order to have be able to utilize international law to their advantage. When you're stateless, you can't use international law because you still come under protectorate status of a foreign country commonly known as the United States of America. Obama knew this. This is why Mitch McConnell kept saying he was going to make Barack H. Obama a one-term president. Mitch McConnell kept saying it over and over again, I'm going to make him a one-term president. Why was Mitch McConnell so interested in removing Barack H. Obama from office? It's because Barack H. Obama was a threat. To who? The bankers and the lobbyists. He knew that Barack H. Obama had the power to wake up the Moors. He knew it. This is why Barack H. Obama said that President Lincoln was his favorite president. He was sending subtle hints to the world that he knows that Lincoln got assassinated for trying to assist Moors. Barack H. Obama knew that the Kennedys got assassinated for what? Trying to assist Moors. Barack H. Obama knew why Malcolm X, i.e. Il-Malik Shabazz, got assassinated, because he was trying to help Moors. Martin Luther King got assassinated because he was trying to help Moors. Good brother Noble Drew Ali got assassinated because he was trying to help Moors. And then Barack H. Obama does what? He goes to Cairo, Egypt to help who? Moors. And what did Moors do? They distracted and started talking about the Pope. That's all they do. They have delayed the Moors' justice. And I need the young Moors to start asking questions. Why haven't the Moorish American so-called teachers and scholars been talking about decolonization? That's the question of the day. Moors don't understand the question of nationality. Nationality is the order of the day. You don't know nothing about nationality because you ain't figured it out over 100 years. Moors don't even talk about decolonization. United Nations has helped over 80 plus territories to decolonize since 1945. Does the Moorish Americans even use the vernacular or the language of the word decolonization? No. They keep talking about the Pope. Doctrines of discovery. How about you go and discover your treaties? How about you go and discover the Charter of the United Nations? How about you go discover the ICJ? How about you discover all the 80 plus territory that's already decolonized? But there lies the problem. Moorish American teachers don't want to talk about decolonization. Negro, black, and colored ministers, reverends, rabbis, and everybody else don't want to talk about decolonization. They want to keep talking about compensation. Compensation is the order of the day amongst Moorish Americans. Moorish Americans have privatized the word Moorish American. They privatized it. It's all about package selling. Why would you want to talk about decolonization if that's going to take money and compensation out of your pockets? The Moorish Americans have privatized the brand name of Moorish American. It's a privatized status listed under a religious organization. That's why it says incorporated. Moorish Science Temple incorporated. Moorish American incorporated. It's privatized by who? Moors. Nobody using the brand of the word Moorish American or Moorish Science Temple but Moors. And I'm not talking about the students. The students are innocent. I'm talking about those who sit at the top of this pyramid scheme. It's a multi-level marketing, MLM, multi-level marketing, privatized pyramid scheme. That's all the Moorish American movement is for those at the top to get compensation instead of talking about decolonization. See, ain't no money in the cure for those at the top of the pyramid scheme that's making money from selling nationality cards. They're selling packages. They want to sell you trust packages. They want to sell you UCC packages. They want to sell you travel cards. They want to sell you, oh, you need to get a library card from the Moorish Americans. You got to get a student ID from the Moorish Americans. That's going to cost you money too. All these IDs cost money. It's all about compensation instead of decolonization. It's about compensation, which keeps you in the status of subjugation. And subjugation keeps the people at the top of this pyramid scheme in the status of compensation while their students in the status of subjugation dealing with hardships. The Moorish American students are losing their houses. The Moorish American students are losing their jobs. The Moorish American students are getting their bank accounts and their at their job, their job, their paychecks are being levied by the IRS. They're losing everything. They're going to jail. While the ones at the top getting all the compensation. Now the ones at the top are asking for all types of entry fees. Oh, you want to come see me? Oh, that's going to cost you $75 to come look at my face. It's all about admission fees now. Admission fees. $20 a door. $30 a door. $50 a door. $75 at the door. This is ridiculous. The Moorish American movement has been privatized by those at the top of the pyramid scheme. Now don't get it twisted. When Noble Drew Ali started this, he didn't start this he started it in good faith. But now it's been turned into bad faith. They now market this to make money. And this is what the Moorish Americans do. That's why they don't want to talk about decolonization. That's why the Moorish American teachers won't teach you about the Charter of the United Nations. That's why the Moorish American teachers won't tell you that you needed your own constitution. They had you distracted studying the colonist constitution, so you remain in the status of what they call protege or Moor subject, i.e. the protected inhabitants by a colonist. The Moorish American teachers are obstructionists. This is shameful. and this is truthful what I'm saying. This information about international law, the United Nations Charter been out for 77 years. They've helped over 80 territories to decolonize. The United Nations has helped more territories to decolonize than they've actually been in service. They've been active for 77 years, but they've helped over 80 territories to decolonize. What have the Moorish Americans done to help decolonize? Nothing. Il-Malik Shabazz was on his way to the United Nations. He was already there talking to people. He was talking to royalties, trying to figure this thing out. Moorish Americans never picked up the torch where Il-Malik failed. It's all about compensation instead of decolonization. But that ends now. I'm telling all the Moorish American teachers, your time is up. You better get all the compensation you can, because pretty soon the Consul General is going to be knocking on your door. Just a matter of time. I digress. Let's get into the class. As the Moors know, I always open up the Constitution. The Constitution is paramount. The Constitution is paramount. It's the first step to return home. It is the instructions of international law. Without a Constitution, there is no state. And without the state, you're stateless. And if you're stateless, you cannot utilize international law for your remedy. You remain subjugated by a foreign power, commonly known as the United States of America, and its United States intergovernmental organization that acts as a power attorney on behalf of the United States of America. Without the Constitution, the Moors might as well sit down and go back to being blackamoors. Because Moorish Americans are still in the status of blackamoor. You ain't going nowhere fast. Black people have more rights than Moorish Americans. Moorish Americans are not recognized nowhere on planet Earth. At least black people as a status, even though it's a de facto status, at least it is recognized by the United States where there's civil rights for black people to seek some type of remedy. Moorish Americans aren't recognized nowhere on planet Earth. Moorish Americans, if it was a status, Moorish American would be at the bottom and black would be a status above Moorish American. And that's the truth. I can prove it every day of the week. And that's the truth. This is shameful what the Moorish American teachers, more specifically, now I'm not talking about the students. The students in fellowship, they don't realize that their ignorance is bliss. But the Moorish American teachers know this information. The Moorish American teachers knew this information before I knew this information. They just don't want to tell you because they're too busy making money. Those days are going to be coming to an end. Let's continue. So as the Moors know, we've been going over the United Nations Charter of 1945 and reading its provisions, i.e. its articles, something that the Moorish American teachers haven't done in decades. So right now, we're finally about to get into the chapter, into chapter 7, right? Chapter 7 is about action with respect to threats to the peace, breaches of the peace, and acts of aggression. Acts of aggression. So today we won't start reading this just yet, but I just want to let the Moors know we have now finally entered into chapter 7, okay? Today we'll continue reading the United States of America's Declaration of Intervention regarding Ukraine versus Russia, right? We'll try to finish that up today. If not, certainly by next class we'll be done with it, all right? So So with that understanding, let's go ahead and get back into the United States of America's Declaration of Intervention that was petitioned to the registrar of the ICJ, right? Just to bring you back up to speed, right? So that's what we've been reading. We left off on section 24, section 24, which is page 15 out of 26. Okay, so I was talking about this word part, right? So I would like to pick it up right here in this word in part. So what we'll do, we'll read this paragraph one more time, and then I'm gonna pick it back up from talking about the word part. That way I can give a little bit more clarity based on what took place between Muhammad V, which is the king of the kingdom of Morocco, and his act of genocide in complicity, right, with the United States of America. We'll talk about that a little bit more before we move on, okay? So, okay, Nova, so let's go ahead and read section 24 of the Declaration of Interjection
Intervention,
yeah, of from the United States of America, okay? All right, thank you, Nova. I'm listening.
Section 24. The United States' understandings are consistent with the court's interpretation of intent to destroy, to mean a dolus specialis that must be present in addition to the inherent required for each of the individual acts involved, and interpretation of in part, quote, end quote, to mean a, quote, substantial part of the particular group, end of quote. The term, quote, substantial part, end of quote, is defined in the legislation that implements the United States' obligations under the convention to mean a part of a protected group of such numerical significance that the destruction or loss of that part would cause the destruction of the group as a viable entity within the nation of which such group is a part. However, the United States recognizes that the court, in assessing whether the alleged targeted part of a protected group is substantial in relation to the overall group, has taken into account both the quantitative element and evidence regarding the geographic location and prominence of the alleged targeted part of the group. Finally, the United States, like the court, understands, quote, destroy, end of quote, in Article 2, to mean the physical or biological rather than cultural destruction of a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group.
Okay, thank you, Noah. All right, so in class 106, I was taking a deeper dive into this word part, right? Because the United States in sections 22 and 23, the United States was talking about whole. Then they started breaking down what they consider to be part, right? They're identifying and coming up with a meaning or interpretation of the word part, right? So I started talking about this word part, right? In part, right? Mm-hmm. So it's the interpretation of in part versus whole, right? So you have whole, in whole, or in part, right? So we were talking about the term as a substantial part, right? And I broke it down in class 106. I was talking about this such numerical significance. So it's about a number game of genocide, right? It's about numbers, right? Okay, so let me take a little deeper, okay? Let me continue on from class 106 to talk about this in part. So as a reminder, now we're looking at, right, the treaty, right, of Madrid Convention, right? So commonly known as the Madrid Convention of 1880. So we were going over Article 15, and then we looked at the footnotes because the United States of America was notating what Muhammad V of the Kingdom of Morocco had sent the United States of America a note, right, to let them know that, hey, we're going to strike Article 15 from this multilateral treaty, okay? Article 15 from a multilateral treaty, okay? All right, so as a refresher, let's go ahead and read both of these paragraphs, okay?
A U.S. note of March 17, 1959, addressed to the Moroccan Ministry of Foreign Affairs, referred to a note from the ministry dated on October 8 of 1958, in which the embassy had been informed that the Moroccan government had decided to strike all prescriptions related to Moroccan nationality from the text of the Madrid Convention. The U.S. note said, in part, quote, the government of the United States of America having unilaterally relinquished certain rights in Morocco with the reemergence of Morocco into independence in 1956, considers that in line with historical developments of Article 15 of the Madrid Convention on Protection of 1880 has become obsolete and without effect. Quote, the government of the United States takes due cognizance, therefore, of the action taken by the Moroccan government as set forth in its above-cited note, which the United States government understands to refer only to Article 15 of the Madrid Convention on Protection of 1880, end of quote.
Okay, thank you very much. All right. Okay, Mark, so let's pick up when we left off in class 106. Right, I was starting to break down once again, what is this in part? Why does the United States of America keep pointing out this word in part? Right, because they're talking about, they relinquished in part, right? They relinquished in part in 1956 certain jurisdiction. Right, in 1956 they relinquished certain jurisdiction. Right, but what is it specifically they're talking about? What was actually relinquished? Okay, did I give you the answer to the test? What was relinquished? What was actually relinquished? Okay, just a moment. They're gonna give you the answer to the test. So right here, the United States of America, I'm gonna read this sentence, okay? It says, the government of the United States of America having unilaterally relinquished certain rights in Morocco, with the reemergence of Morocco into independence in 1956, right? So then we learn that, okay, they talk about certain rights in Morocco. Well, what certain rights, right? What are the certain rights? What are these certain rights in Morocco? Well, one of them is about what? Jurisdiction, right? We're learning about relinquishment of some jurisdiction in 1956, but what else are they relinquishing? What else is being relinquished? Okay, the Sultan Mohammed V turns around from his seat of the Moroccan government, he turns around and strikes Moroccan nationality from what? He strikes it from the Treaty of Madrid, right? He strikes it from the Treaty of Madrid of 1880. Let me lower this down. The Sultan turns around and strikes from Article 15 of the Treaty of Madrid Convention, right, of 1880. The Sultan does that, right, in a conspiracy with the United States of America. But what are they striking, really? They're striking the Moors, right? It was all about the Moroccan nationality, about the Moor, M-O-R. The Moroccan nationality being struck. Okay, this is going on in 1956, and more specifically 1958 and 1959, right? So we got 1958 and 1959, okay? But listen, Morris. Listen very carefully. Then the United States turns around and says, okay, they go back to the treaty of 1836. What type of treaty is this? Bilateral treaty. See, the Treaty of Madrid was what? Multilateral treaty. So now the United States of America goes back to the Treaty of Peace and Friendship of 1836 and they add some footnotes. Look what they add. They say, okay, they went back what's called retroactively. Okay, they went retroactively back to the Treaty of Peace and Friendship bilateral treaty and added these notes. Now, a conspiracy to genocide took place between 1956 and 1959. Some genocide took place, so now the United States of America retroactively is going back to this bilateral treaty because some conditions changed. Some conditions changed. What condition changed? Okay, in the Treaty of Peace and Friendship, now you come down to what? You come down to Article 6. There's other articles as well. Article 6 talked about what? Moors. right? Moors. So if Muhammad the Fifth agreed to strike Moroccan nationality from the treaties, now the United States of America is going back saying now that Moroccan, Article 6, Treaty of Peace and Friendship, 1836, now Article 6, this word more, is what? Obsolete and without effect. Let's go back to it. Let's go back. Now all of a sudden now.
The audacity.
Yeah. Now all of a sudden now, look. Now all of a sudden Moroccan nationality is obsolete and without effect. So now the United States of America goes back to the bilateral treaty and they start to say, okay, if that's the case, now we gotta go back to the bilateral treaties retroactively and say this word more is obsolete and without effect. More specifically, you go down to Article 20, okay? You go down to Article 20 because the Moors love to talk about Article 20 and 21. Why? Because that's about what? Civil and criminal jurisdiction. The Moors have been trying to stand on their square with Article 20 and 21, and they didn't know what they was talking about. But I'm going to help the Moors. I'm here to help the Moors. Listen, Moors, I'm going to help you get into scholarship instead of fellowship. You can be in fellowship of scholarship. How about that? Or just be in pure scholarship and go do your own research. Moors got to get out of fellowship. That's important to understand. Watch this. So now in Article 20 and 21, going back to the Treaty of Madrid footnotes, now that the Muhammad the Fifth has said now the Moors' nationality has been struck from the record, right? They're no longer Moroccan nationality. They don't have more Moroccan nationals no more because the nationality is obsolete and without effect. Now they go retroactively back to the treaty. United States and now going back and say, okay, in Article 21, it says, if a citizen of the United States should kill or wound a Moor, or on the contrary, if a Moor shall kill or wound a citizen of the United States, the law of the country shall take place, and equal justice shall be rendered. The consul assisting at the trial, and if any delinquent shall make his escape, the consul shall not be answerable for him in any manner whatsoever. So what's happening here in Article 21? Now that the word more is obsolete and without effect, the Moors don't exist no more. All the Moors now are what you call Americanized. There are no more Moors. The Moors have been Americanized through an act of genocide between Muhammad V and the United States of America. And this is why they keep saying in part. Okay, let's go back. They keep saying in part. Why they keep using this word in part? Why they keep talking about in part? It's because they knew they was performing an act of genocide, so they wanted to be very careful of the words they were using. So they didn't want to say in whole. They said in part. Why? Because they were not enacting real legislation through the Congress of the United States of America. So the Congress, the House of Representatives, and the Senate wasn't going to turn around and say, yeah, these Moors are no longer Moroccans. They're all Americans according to law. So now the United States of America keeps putting in part because they know they're flirting with a violation of genocide. Okay, so they go back over to the bilateral. Follow me, Moors, follow me. So Article 20, listen, Treaty of Peace and Friendship, 1836, Article 20, if any of the citizens of the United States or any persons under their protection, well, who is under their protection? More subjects, i.e. Moroccans. So now the United States of America is saying, these are no longer Moors under our protection. Who are they now? They're Americans. They're not Moors anymore because the word more is now what? Obsolete and without effect. You see what the United States of America did retroactively? So the Moors have been running around saying, we Moors. And the United States of America saying they don't want to recognize Moors as Moors. They want to recognize Moors as Moorish Americans through a religious corporation, because anybody can say what they are when they say it through a church. I can sit here and tell you I'm Baptist. Baptist is not a nationality. So when Moors say they're Moorish American is a church status. It's a religious status. It's not a nationality. Baptist is not a nationality. Moorish American is not a nationality. It's a brand through a church or a corporation. The Moorish American literally keeps saying it's the Moorish American. Moorish Science Temple Incorporated. Moorish American is incorporated. There's no such thing as Moorish Americans. And then the Sultan turns around and says, yeah, these Moors can no longer proclaim their nationality as Moorish subjects, i.e. Moroccan subjects, because now it's what?
Obsolete.
And without effect. So now the United States goes back retroactively. Be patient with me, Moors. Listen. And they say this Article 2021 is not applicable for Moors to be able to use for their own defense of consular court. Moors can't use consular court no more. Why? It's because all the Moors became Americanized by the acts of the United States of America's legislation, by their Naturalization Act, by their 14th Amendment, etc. Then the Sultan turns around between the year 1956 and 1959 and gets into conspiracy to so-called strike Article 15 of a treaty to help the United States of America get rid of who?
Moors.
Right? So, okay. Listen, the timeline. Let's go back to the timeline from class 106. All right. So what happens? Right here, this line item 10. It says, Muhammad V declares a Declaration of Independence March 2nd, 1956, right? Then all of a sudden, the United States puts together Public Law 856, August 1st, 1956, okay? And in that Public Law 856, the United States of America recognized the Moors as being what? Moor subjects and protégés, right? Let's go to it real quick as a reminder. Public Law 856, okay? Public Law 856, okay? And in the Public Law 856, okay, there it is, for everybody at home that needs the reference point. Public Law 856, okay? So you come down, and the United States of America recognized who? They recognized that they had jurisdiction over who? They had jurisdiction, move it up. They had jurisdiction over subjects of Morocco or others who may be designated as protégés. So the United States of America in Public Law 856 points out subjects of Morocco and protégés, right? Subjects of Morocco. Now you go back to the 1880 Convention of Madrid, subjects of Morocco. You go up to Article 15, subjects of Morocco, right? Subjects of Morocco who had protections in Morocco. All of a sudden now, you throw down, this was in 1880, now the new Sultan, Muhammad V, because he's acting brand new after 1956, he says all of a sudden now the Sultan, Moroccan nationality for Moors is obsolete and without effect.
Wow.
Okay, now listen. You go back now to the Treaty of Peace and Friendship. What type of treaty? Bilateral treaty that the United States of America now is throwing the Moors underneath the bus because they think the Sultan gave them permission to do so. Okay? So they say termination in part. Then they say extraterritorial jurisdiction in Morocco relinquished by the United States, October 6, 1956. Well, I wonder why they was relinquishing jurisdiction. It's because Moors didn't exist no more. Because of what the Sultan was doing with the United States of America, they said Moors don't exist as a name. That they don't have a right to proclaim themselves as Moroccans. That way the Moors could not use Article 15 of the Madrid Convention anymore. We're going to go deeper. Look what they put. Look what the United States puts in the footnote. 8 Stat 484. Okay, where's 8 Stat 484? Okay, let's go back over to Public Law 856. Public Law 856. Public Law 856. Right here. Statute 8 Stat 484 34 Stat 2905. Okay, there it is. 8 Stat 484. Let's go back to the treaty. Peace and friendship. Go back to the treaty. Thank you for your patience. Go back to the treaty. Treaty of Peace and Friendship, 1836. 8 Stat 484. You see? They're telling you where to go find the evidence to show the pattern of what they've done to the mold. Right? So once you take a look at 8 Stat 484, you go over to Public Law 856, keeping in mind that Public Law 856 is synonymous to United States Code 22 U.S.C. 141 to 143, and Public Law 856 is synonymous to Statute 8 Stat 484 34 Stat 2905, and Public Law 856 is synonymous to AA 222 141, which is assessed in the Department of Justice. And your Moorish American teachers keep telling you to put that on your identification card. As a reminder that Moore's status is what?
Obsolete and without effect.
Obsolete and without effect. Okay. And we are acquiescing to it and saying we're the 222-141 Moors. And this ain't nothing but a placeholder for an inmate number. Because it's all assessed back to the Department of Justice, has jurisdiction over all this codified language. Because the Moors are now, the Moors have been what? Americanized. The Moors are now American nationals because of what Muhammad V tried to pull with the United States of America. But it was what? An act of genocide. It's a human rights violation. So therefore, it's null and void. It's null and void what they did. But yet, they can still be brought up on charges. Right? Because it was an attempt of genocide. Okay. It was an attempt of genocide. Attempt of genocide. Okay. Okay, so what the United States of America did, right, along with Muhammad V of the Kingdom of Morocco, because he was all of a sudden acting brand new, right? Now you go to Article 3 of the Genocide Convention, Nova.
Article 3, the following acts shall be punishable. A, genocide. B, conspiracy to commit genocide. C, direct and public incitement to commit genocide. D, attempt to commit genocide. And E, complicity in genocide.
Okay, so everything that Muhammad V of the Kingdom of Morocco did, along with the United States of America, right, was what? It was an attempt to commit genocide, right? It was a conspiracy to commit genocide, right? It was complicity in genocide, right? And it was a direct and public incitement to commit genocide because of all that correspondence, right? The United States is literally making it public. You see that public incitement? Okay, public incitement, 1836. That's a public incitement right there. You see that? Termination in part, extraterritorial jurisdiction in Morocco, relinquished by the United States, October 6, 1956. And they say, go down into this codified language of 8 Stat 484. Right? So they're putting that in retroactively because of what? Because of what the Sultan did in 1880 between the United States and America. They're trying to sneak it in to say that the Moors' nationality is obsolete and without effect according to Article 15. You see? All right. So let's go back and look at the timeline again. Timeline. You see the conspiracy right here, Moors? Look. So you got right here, line item number 10. Muhammad V declared Declaration of Independence March 2nd, 1956. Then the United States put together Public Law 856, which is August 1st, 1956, right? August 1st, 1956, which is
856, August 56, right? And then the next thing you know, Section 12, United States Public Law 856, Park Relinquishment Policy of October 6, 1956. So look, March, then August, then October. See what's happening? So they're waiting for the Sultan to have his independence from France, because France was controlling the entire gambit of the Empire of Morocco. So as soon as France was out the way after March 2nd, 1956, the United States of America moves in. Why? Okay, Mort, listen. Listen. Now we gotta go slightly backwards again. What's this I have up here? This is France versus United States of America, 1952. Blood judgment. Okay? What page is this? What page is this? This is 199 in the judgment. Okay? 199. Okay, on the PDF, it's page 27. PDF 27, but on the judgment itself, it says 199, okay? Okay, now if you want to use Control F, if you want to use Control F to find it faster, put in the word satisfactory. Type in Control F, satisfactory, and take you to this paragraph, okay? So what happened in 1952 before all of this acts of genocide took place between Muhammad V and the United States of America? So between 1956 and 1959, some genocide happened. But what happened prior to 1956? Okay, now you go to the case of 1952. Okay, Nova, can you read this paragraph on?
The court is not called upon to examine the particular articles of the Act of Algeciras which are involved. It considers it sufficient to the state as its opinion that the consular jurisdiction of the United States continues to exist to the extent that may be necessary to render effective those provisions of the Act of Algeciras which depend on the existence of consular jurisdiction.
Pause. So what's happening here, boys? Why are we reading this paragraph? It's because the ICJ is pointing out that since the Moors are asleep, and in 1952, the Sultan, Muhammad V, had no power because Muhammad V was still under the contract commonly known as what? Treaty of Fez, 1912. So the Sultan had no power. France was running the whole show. France was called a de facto Sultan. What does de facto mean? Of fact. But he wasn't. France wasn't a de jure Sultan, but France was the de facto Sultan. Okay? So Muhammad V didn't have no power. Okay? So right here, the ICJ is looking at this case that France brought to the ICJ utilizing Chapter 6, right, of the Charter of the United Nations in order to settle a Pacific settlement of dispute. Okay? Now listen. So the ICJ is looking at this case saying, man, France has dropped the ball because France didn't wake up the Moors like they were supposed to. The United States of America now is trying to have 100% control over the Moors. France don't want the United States of America to have control over the Moors. So now the United States of America realizes that France didn't do their job to wake up the Moors. The United States of America didn't wake up the Moors. And the Moors were mandated to run the Empire of Morocco again back in 1906, the Act of Algeciras, right? This is why they're talking about the Act of Algeciras. The Act of Algeciras was a mandate to resurrect, right, to resurrect the Moors again. Right, out of 123 articles, the word Moor is mentioned 42 times. It just keeps saying Moorish, 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 42 times. In the Act of Algeciras of 1906, out of 123 articles, the word Moor is mentioned 42 times. That's important to understand. That tells you what? The object and purpose of that treaty was to bring the Moorish government back into power. So since France didn't do it, the United States of America didn't do it, the Sultan didn't have the power to do it. So now all of a sudden, the United States of America is left saying, listen, we want control over the Moors. And the ICJ is looking at this case saying, oh my God, France, nobody's woke up these Moors according to this treaty. Everybody has failed the Moors up until this point of 1952. Okay, so, all right, Nova, so let's read now this second paragraph, okay?
This interpretation of the act in some instances leads to results which may not appear to be entirely satisfactory. But that is an unavoidable consequence of the manner in which the Al Jazeera's conference dealt with the questions of consular jurisdiction. The court cannot, by way of interpretation, derive from the act a general rule as to full consular jurisdiction, which it does not contain. On the other hand, the court cannot disregard particular provisions involving a limited resort to consular jurisdiction, which are in fact contained in the act and which are still in force as far as the relations between the United States and Morocco are concerned.
Okay, so what happened? You see what the ICJ said? They said right here, they said, it appears to be entirely satisfactory, right? It appears to be entirely satisfactory, right? So hold up. Let me start the sentence from the top. This interpretation of the act in some instances leads to results which may not appear to be entirely satisfactory. What are they talking about? The Moors are supposed to be woke up. So that's the day, like, we can't even give a jurisdiction to the Moors because they still have what? Acquiesced. They're still asleep. They still run around talking about they're Moorish Americans. There ain't no such thing as Moorish Americans. The Moors are Moroccans. The people are named after the land, and the land is named after the people. The land is Morocco. We are Moroccans, not Americans. Listen. So from the top, this interpretation of the act, in some instances, leads to a result which may not appear to be entirely satisfactory. So the ICJ was a little upset. But that is an unavoidable consequence of the manner in which the Al Jazeera's conference dealt with the question of consular jurisdiction. So ICJ is saying, this is an unavoidable consequence because these Moors are still asleep. We're going to have to give the United States of America a limited jurisdiction over Moors in 1952 because the Moors run around saying they're Moorish Americans. The Moors run around saying they was Negro, Black, colored. The Moors run around saying they was Indians. The Moors would run around saying they were Pan-Africans. The Moors would run around saying they was Hebrew. The Moors would run around saying they're Islam. Talking about them Muslims. Muslim is not a nationality. Moors were saying everything but two words. Moor, i.e. Moroccan. But Nova Drali told us we were Moroccan. Nova Drali said we're descendants of Moroccans. Then the Moors, the sellout Moors took over and coined the word Moorish American and coined the word Moor Science Temple. These are all privatized words. They're commercialized words. They're commercialized entities now. And the ICJ is sitting right here. It's an unavoidable consequence that these Moors are still asleep and acquiescing to the fact the United States and France is holding on to this power. Let's take it from the top again. This interpretation of the act in some instances leads to results which may not appear to be entirely satisfactory. But that is an unavoidable consequence of the manner in which the Al Jazeera's conference dealt with the question of consular jurisdiction. The court cannot, by way of interpretation, derive from a general rule as to full consular jurisdiction, which it does not contain. See, the United States of America wanted full consular jurisdiction, right? They were petitioning full jurisdiction over Moors in the West. So what does the ICJ say? The ICJ says, on the other hand, the court cannot disregard particular provisions invoking a limited resort to consular jurisdiction. So the ICJ gave the United States of America a limited consular jurisdiction. However, the ICJ did not give the United States of America full consular jurisdiction. It gave the United States of America a limited consular jurisdiction, which are in fact contained in the act and which are still in force as far as the relations between the United States Americans and Morocco, the Moroccans, are concerned, two different parties.
Mm-hmm.
And the Moorish American tell you, Moorish American and Moroccan is the same thing. They just made, even the ICJ just made a distinction between the United States, which is Americans, and Morocco, which is Moroccans. The Moors have been lied to. Moors have been hoodwinked, bamboozled, and led astray. This came out in 1952. We're in the year 2023.
Yep.
It's been over 70 years since this case came out. This is shameful. Moorish American teachers don't teach about France versus the United States of America. They don't read it. They know if they read it out loud, it would start to do what? Liberate the people. Oh, Moorish American teachers don't want to liberate the people. They want to subjugate the people, because subjugation means compensation, because the Moorish American movement has been privatized as a pyramid scheme. And the ICJ is sitting here feeling sorry for Moors. I'll read it again. This interpretation of the act, in some instances, leads to results which may not appear to be entirely satisfactory. The ICJ is upset. But that is an unavoidable consequence of the manner in which the Algeciras Conference dealt with the question of consular jurisdiction. Why was the ICJ talking about the conference dealt with the question of consular jurisdiction? Because the act of Algeciras was supposed to wake up the Moors.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody did. Guess who else didn't wake up the Moors? The Moors didn't wake up the Moors. The Moors turned the Moors into what? They speedy and Americanized former Moors. The 1933 Resolution 75 that you see all over Ari Bay Publications. Ari Bay Publications keeps pumping out this Resolution 75. Ari Bay Publications keeps talking about the fact that the Moors are Moorish Americans. Ari Bay Publications keep telling the Moors that we are the true Americans and we're not. Ari Bay Publications keep talking about this AA-222-141. This is shameful. And this has to stop. This was 1952, for God's sake. And the ICJ was upset. I'm upset. I'm the chief judge of consular court. I got the same mentality as the International Court of Justice judges, because they're looking at what? The treaties. They're looking at the treaties. Okay. Let's go to the Act of Algeciras. Act of Algeciras, 1906. There it is. Okay. I'm going to put in the word control F. I'm going to type in the word more. M-O-O-R. For all the Moors at home, type in the word more. Control F. M-O-O-R. And it says the word more is in here 42 times. 42 times. It automatically takes you to Article 2. Can you please read Article 2 for me? No.
Sure. Article 2, the police shall be under the sovereign authority of His Majesty the Sultan. It shall be recruited by the Moxen from Moorish Mohammedans, commanded by Moorish Cades, and distributed in the 8 ports open to commerce.
Okay, so Article 2 off the top. Who's supposed to be in control of the police? Moors. Says right here, more. See it? Moors. Says right here, Moorish Mohammedans and the Moorish Cades. Who are the Moorish Mohammedans? Who are the Moorish Cades? Okay, you come over here in French, which is interpretation of treaties, right? Okay, who are the Muslim men? Moroccans. Okay, Who are the Muslim men? Moroccans. Okay? Who are the Moorish kings right here? Moroccans. Moors and Moroccans. In the 1906, Act of the Sarahs was a mandate for the Moors to have sovereign authority. Why aren't the Moorish American teachers underscoring the Act of the Sarahs of 1906? Why don't the Moorish American teachers read the Act of the Sarahs out loud? They don't do it. They don't read Madrid Convention of 1880, Article 15 out loud. They don't do it. You know why? It would start to liberate the people. They ain't interested in liberation. They're interested in subjugation and compensation. This is sad. But we're going to fix this, right? Why am I going so deep into this? Okay. Let's go back to what the United States was saying in their Declaration of Intervention. They were trying to underscore this word in part, interpretation in part. Now keep in mind, it's talking about Ukraine versus Russia. But I picked up on that word because Noah Dreyse said, do what? Learn from the Europeans. I started picking up on the word in part. I said, there's something about that word. I need to know more about it. I started diving in deep because I said, I've seen this word in part before. Mm-hmm. So I go back to what? Treaty interpretations. And I put in control F. And lo and behold, what did I realize? In the 1880 Treaty of Madrid, the word in part is in there. Then lo and behold, since it's talking about the relinquishment of 1956, I said, huh. Let me go over to Public Law 856, because I know that's what they're talking about. And I said, well, the word in part is not in there, but guess what word replaced it? The word policy. That's in part, because it wasn't law. A policy is not law, right? So they went halfway. But guess what? Ain't no such thing as halfway crooks, right? They scared to death. They scared to look.
Yeah.
Shout out to Mobb Deep. Okay. Listen. So I said, okay, 1856, then it dawned on me, I had also saw it in the Treaty of Peace and Friendship, because I actually read the treaties, because Moorish American teachers don't read you this stuff out loud. Moorish American teachers have never taken the time to talk about the ratification of what these steps are all about. They don't show you this. They'll copy-paste everything below this down, but they never copy-paste this too. They don't talk about it. Because they don't want the Moors to know about what? Ratification.
Right.
And depository. And promulgation. They don't want Moors to know about those three words. Ratification, depository, and promulgation. They don't want the Moors to know. I'm starting to study the Moorish American teachers. I'm studying them.
Right.
I study the Moorish American teachers like I study the colonists, because I study colonists and obstructionists. That's what I do. So then I came over here and I said, huh, there's that word in part. I said, okay. Then I said, okay, I connected it. 8 Stat 484. I said, uh-huh. I knew this was about Public Law 856. I knew it. Because I said, but bam, there it is. 8 Stat 484. You see, I'm just going back, right?
Uh-huh.
I'm following what's called the path of genocide they've done. Right? And they made it public incitement. Okay.
Yeah.
Public incitement, right? It's public incitement. It's public incitement. Let's go back over to it. Public incitement. There it is. Right? This is the Convention on the Prevention and Punishment on the Crime of Genocide of 1948. And right here it says what? It says direct and public incitement. Right? They cited it publicly. Okay? Okay. All right. Okay, listen up, Morris. I'm not done. Act of Sarah, 1906. Okay, listen to me, Morris. So if the United States of America went back to the bilateral treaty of 1836 and put this word in part in, because extraterritorial jurisdiction, Morocco, was relinquished by the United States because they say the Moors don't exist no more, then guess what else happened? Okay, now you come on to 1906. Act of the Sarahs, now the United States of America can say these Moors, even though it says 42 times about the Moorish government, but ain't no Moors left no more. So the United States of America is feeling real good about themselves. They like, these Morris can't ever run Morris governments if there's no such thing as Morris.
Right.
This is about Moroccan governments, but the Sultan said the Moors are obsolete without effect. You see how deep this genocide act is going? This is the United States the entire time. They like, man, the ICJ, let's go back to the ICJ. They said the ICJ said we can hold on to a limited consular jurisdiction. But what did the United States want? They wanted full consular jurisdiction. They found a way to do it. Mm-hmm. Getting genocide act with the Sultan Muhammad V. Mm-hmm. They found a way to get what? Full jurisdiction over who? More subjects, so now blacks, Negroes, colors, and whatever other nom de guerre and misnomer they can come up amongst themselves in their community. Right? Like Black Panther. Morris came up with that. It's a misnomer, right? It's a nom de guerre. But it don't say Moor, it don't say Moroccan. So the United States appreciates when Moors call themselves what? Moorish Americans. That's a favorable term to the United States of America. Because the Moors ain't calling themselves the Moroccans. The Moors are not calling themselves the Moroccans. They're not calling themselves the Moroccans. So therefore, you ain't calling yourself Moroccan. That means you don't have Moroccan nationality. Which means if you ain't seeking Moroccan nationality, that means you ain't seeking how to establish what? A Moroccan government. The two go hand in hand. There is no Moroccan government without Moroccans. There's no Moroccans without Moroccan governments. And this is why the Moors kept running around talking about, we got a Moorish American government. There ain't no such thing. In the United States and the FBI was laughing the whole time. The whole time. Okay. What's happening, Morris? Listen to me. Okay. You see that? That's the Moroccan flag, right? But it's based in interpretation of whose flag it belongs to. Uh-oh. The Kingdom of Morocco have adopted the empire flag that represents the empire of Morocco, and they've taken the empire flag of Morocco and made it their provincial state flag of their small kingdom of Morocco. They took an empire flag and turned it into a Lone Star State flag of the Kingdom of Morocco. When did that take place? Okay, first of all, when did this rendition of the flag come out? The red flag with the green star. Well, it came out in 1915, okay? So Sultan Yusuf, Y-U-S-E-F, in 1915, created this flag, 1915. But what happened in 1915? Well, in 1915, France was overseeing the empire because of the Treaty of Fez of 1912. So France turned around and told the Sultan, hey man, you can't use that flag. Me being France, France was controlling, it was called the French Zone. France was controlling the empire. Morocco was as the de facto Sultan. France tells Sultan Yusuf, hey man, you can't use this flag, but you can use it inland. But you can't use it at the sea. So, in 1915, the Sultan could use it inland, but couldn't use it in the sea or on an international level. This flag did not get on an international level until 1955, 1956. So from 1915 to 1955, France was not technically allowing this flag to be recognized as the empire flag. France said, okay, you got to put an insignia in the corner, right here, right? Right here in the corner, you got to put France's flag in this corner called a canton, right? The canton, which represents France, was overseeing the Empire of Morocco. That's what France wanted, right? So then France allowed that flag to be represented, a French Morocco flag, because France overseeing the empire. So from 1915 to 1955, France was overseeing this flag as a de facto sultan. Now all of a sudden, March 2nd, 1956, Mohammed V declares his independence, March 2nd, 1956, and then he turns around immediately, goes to the United Nations, December 1956, and proclaims the Kingdom of Morocco as a state, and the Mohammed V took the empire flag with him. Keeping in mind, France had to agree to that. So France agreed with the Kingdom of Morocco, Mohammed V, that he could make this flag the provincial flag of the Kingdom of Morocco. But yet, this flag represents the Empire of Morocco. Now do you understand another reason why Mohammed V turned around and threw the Moors underneath the bus? Because he wanted to keep this flag all to himself. See, the reality is the Kingdom of Morocco should establish their own provincial flag, like AMPAC. AMPAC has its own provincial flag. AMPAC has its own provincial flag right here, right? AMPAC as a provincial Moroccan state in the Empire of Morocco, right, recognizes the Empire flag of Morocco as being the mother flag. Okay? So AMPAC's flag is subordinate to the Empire flag. But wait a minute. The Kingdom of Morocco is holding on to the Empire flag of what? Morocco. How do you spell Morocco? M-O-R-O-C-C-O. You can't spell Morocco without saying Moor. It's a Moorish flag of Morocco for Moors. But the Kingdom of Morocco took the flag with them under what's called salvage. They salvaged the flag and made it their provincial state flag in the greater Empire of Morocco. So the Kingdom of Morocco acts as one Lone Star state. Now wait a minute, listen to me. This is once again another act of genocide, because they're taking our flag that represents the empire, they're making it their Lone Star state flag. Now listen, imagine if, let's say, the colonial state of Texas, follow me, imagine if Texas, who calls itself the Lone Star state, imagine if Texas said, you know what, we're going to say we're a Lone Star state. Texas going to say that they are the America, and Texas takes the United States of America flag with them, all by themselves. And the other 49 territories aren't using the United States of America's flag no more, because Texas took it with them. hear what I'm saying?
No.
It's crazy, ain't it? I'm going to say it again. Imagine if Texas said, yo, we out. We're going to take the United States of America flag with us and consider ourselves a Lone Star state. And also, we're going to call ourselves the America. Only Texas is America. Everything else ain't America no more, according to their jurisdiction, their colonial jurisdiction. Well, that's the same thing the Kingdom of Morocco did. Kingdom of Morocco, in this example, would be like Texas, succeeding away from the Union and taking the Empire flag with them and the name of what? Morocco. So they had to turn around with an act, right? They had to use their pen to escheat and hypothecate. They had to escheat and hypothecate a conspiracy to steal the Moors, M-O-R, M-O-R, Moroccan, M-O-R, Moroccan's nationality, so that the kingdom of Morocco could then turn around and keep the empire flag. So the reality is this. Allegedly, that's the kingdom of Morocco's flag, allegedly. But the reality is this flag belongs to the empire. And the kingdom of Morocco needs their own provincial flag that's subordinate to the empire flag. That's the truth. Now, I want to say for the record that right now, the king of the kingdom of Morocco, who is Muhammad VI, right? So you had Muhammad V, who was a part of genocide. And then his son, Hassan II, right, continued on with that same narrative. Then Hassan II's son is named Muhammad VI. Muhammad VI right now is the current incumbent king of the kingdom of Morocco. Next up is his son, the prince, Hassan III. His son is in his 20s. His son, Hassan III, and his father, Muhammad VI, it's time for them to have a conversation. Because the Moors are back. And the Moors understand what our birthright is regarding the Empire Morocco flag. Because the Arabs, and no disrespect to Arabs, but the Arabs have been acting as administrators, trustees, and managers over the Moorish Empire. And they know it. That's why if you go look at their constitution, right? Go look at the constitution of the Kingdom of Morocco, and the Arabs who call themselves Moroccans also identify the true indigenous people of the land, and they call them the Amazigh people, which are truly Moors, the true Moroccans. This is why in North Africa, listen to me, this is AMPAC study session, this is an educational platform. Let's educate the people. This is why the Arabs of North Africa keep telling people they are not Africans. They keep saying they're what? Arabs. They keep telling the whole world the truth. They are Arabs. And everybody keeps saying, no, you're Africans. They keep saying, no, we're Arabs. Why doesn't the world believe them? They're Arabs who's sitting in the offices, in the chairs, as administrators, trustees, and managers over the Moorish Empire. Over the Moroccan Empire. This is why right now, if you go look up the Kingdom of Morocco's constitution, you see it's two parties in it. Did you know that Tunis and Tripoli and Algiers have now recognized the indigenous people of the land? They're starting to recognize who the true indigenous people are. They're finally starting to admit who the true indigenous people are. They're finally doing it. Congratulations to them. I'm proud of them for admitting it, finally. But this flag right here belongs to Moors, i.e. Moroccans. And it can be shared with the kingdom of Morocco. But if the kingdom of Morocco turns around and say, no, this flag is the absolute flag of the kingdom of Morocco, then guess what? That's going to create a contentious dispute. And through that contentious dispute, Constitutional Court and the International Court of Justice is going to find out about all this genocide that took place to cut out the Moors from their rightful inheritance. So, my recommendation to the Moors is this. At some point, we're going to have to sit down with the Kingdom of Morocco's King Muhammad VI and his son, the prince, Hassan III, to say, look, we got to talk. Because what Muhammad V did was an act of genocide, and the kingdom of Morocco can be held liable for genocide. Because Muhammad V started this genocide act, and his son, Hassan II, never went back retroactively and struck that genocide from the record. Hassan II didn't go back to the United States of America and say, man, you know, my dad was tripping. We need to get back to the treaties. These Moors deserve their rights. So Hassan II didn't go back and correct the record retroactively. Muhammad VI, the king right now, didn't go back and correct the record with the United States of America to give the Moors back their rights. Pretty soon his son gonna be the king, because from my understanding, Muhammad VI is a little sick right now, right? Unfortunately, he's under the weather. His son most likely gonna end up becoming the king in his 20s. His son is hip. He's on social media. When his son finds out about all this genocide that took place between 1956 and 1959, maybe his son, Hassan III, will sit down with the Moors of the West, because this flag is gonna become a point of contention. Because this flag don't belong to nobody except the empire. It sure as heck don't exclusively belong to the kingdom of Morocco. And the kingdom of Morocco should understand that in 1952, when the flag of Morocco was in existence in 1952 when this case came out. That flag was representing the empire. So Muhammad V turns around and exclusively proclaims the flag as being the Kingdom of Morocco's flag under salvage status, because there was no more what? Sultan. Muhammad V left the office of Sultan. Muhammad V left the office in the empire's central government void of a government, and took the empire flag with him in a conspiracy with France, the United States of America, to take that flag under salvage status. Well, the Moors are no longer acquiescing. The Moors won't make the proper claim to the empire flag. And anybody calling themselves Moroccans will come under that flag in each of the territories of planet Earth. What's the problem, Moors? What do I have up here on the screen? Let's talk about this. Why is the United States of America constantly trying to undermine the Moors? It's because of the bankers. That's Jerome Powell. That right there, Janet Yellen. Jerome Powell and the Federal Reserve, along with the IMF and the Bretton Woods, right? Brentton, Bretton Woods. Bretton Woods was established 1944 between Great Britain and United States of America, or shall I say United States International Organization. And Great Britain established an international banking, a global bank, a world bank, under what they call the Bretton Woods of 1944-1945, before the charter was fully activated and granted by France. France had to grant for the charter to come into existence. So the problem is with the United States, Joe Biden, who's sitting in the office of the year 2023, Antony Blinken, who's sitting there as the Secretary of State in 2023, and Merrick Garland, who's sitting there as the Attorney General 2023, they all work for this dude, Jerome Powell. And Jerome Powell works for all the international bankers, such as the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, that comes under the Bretton Woods. So does the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development. It's called the IBRD, acronym, IBRD, the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development. Both the IMF and the IBRD fall under the Bretton Woods banking, along with the Federal Reserve. All this is owned by the international bankers of the United States in cooperation with some other European states, etc. So as the bankers who have been trying to undermine the Moors, the bankers have been making money since the beginning of time. They're nothing but bookies. They play the middle. When the Civil War took place between 1861 and 1865, guess who made all the money? The bankers. They were funding the war. They bet on both sides for the most part. J.P. Morgan, Rockefellers, all of them, they all put their money up to help states. They helped the United States of America through the Civil War. The United States of America was defaulting on those loans they owed the bankers. Since the United States of America couldn't pay the money back to the bankers because it was a predatory loan that the bankers gave the United States of America, the United States of America defaulted. So therefore, in 1871, they established what? United States Municipal Corporation, i.e. Federal Corporation. Hold up. Hold up. All the Moors know about this. Cornell Law School, Legal Information Institute. If you type in 28 U.S.C. Code, subsection 3002, section 15A, all the Moors know about this. You go down to section 15A, which is the definition of terms. You go down to section 15A, and the United States will tell you exactly what it is. The United States means a federal corporation ran by who? The bankers. Right? The bankers. So the bankers, since the United States of America couldn't pay back the loan, the bankers took the United States of America under salvage. Then they established a shell company called the United States, 1871. Well, before they did that, what did they bankers do? They threw the Moors under the bus. 13th Amendment, 14th Amendment, 15th Amendment, Naturalization Act of 1870 made the Moors Americans. Because the bankers don't like to take the risk of knowing that Moors can come back and control the narrative of banking and jurisdiction. Bankers don't like courts. They know the Moors control consular court. Bankers don't like that type of risk, knowing that Moors can control the narrative and can adjudicate bankers based on what's called organized crime. So the bankers have been undermining the Moors. And the bankers control all the politicians. Okay. Listen. What is it the United States is scared of? The United States is not scared of Moors. They don't fear Moors. They actually respect Moors, but they know the Moors are going to wake up all the Americans and tell the Americans the truth about the history. And what's going to happen when the Moors tell the Americans the truth? That's what's going to happen. What happened on January 6, 2021, when the Americans stormed the Capitol, this is what these people are afraid of. They are afraid of these people. That's what they're afraid of. They're not afraid of Moors. They're concerned about these dudes.
Because, babe, the last time it happened, this is what happened.
The legislators was ducking. They wasn't running away from Moors. They was running away from Americans that they have exceeded and hypothecated. Who exceeded and hypothecated the Americans? The bankers and the legislators and the judges have all sold out. All of them. Listen. So when the Moors see this single Federal Reserve note, the Moors understand where the power is. The Moors do understand the basic concept, don't get me wrong. Where's the power according to this symbology? Okay, this seal represents who? The international bankers. They're the trustees. And they have put in the United States Federal Corporation as managers. So who are the managers? Okay, let's go back to it. Remember I told you the power is always to the left. So the international bankers and the regional bankers, so the Federal Reserve is the regional bankers, then they got the IMF, they got the World Bank, right? They got the International Bank of Development and Reconstruction, right? Oh, Reconstruction and Development. So what do I mean when I say the IBRD, right? See, the United States bankers make most of their money from the military complex, right? Industrial complex, the military-industrial complex. Bankers been making money off of waging bets on wars. So Lockheed Martin, as an example, is a war machine. The United States Federal Corporation is a war machine to make weapons. The bankers make a lot of money off of selling weapons around the world or leasing weapons to other states. This is the same thing the bankers did to the United States of America when they were fighting the South. This is the same thing the bankers did to the South when they were fighting the North. They're just bookies. They've been playing this game for hundreds of years. So now they're playing it on an international level. Right? So this is the Federal Reserve and the international bankers, and they put in managers. Who are the managers? Okay, let's go back to the managers. Here are the managers. My slide disappeared. It said insurrection. I don't see it anymore. Okay, let me just pull it up real quick. Okay, Chad, thank you for your patience. Hold up. Oh, it was the same slide. Oh, true. Okay. Okay, Chad, 3 seconds. Okay, Moore, so trustee, manager. Who's the manager? Okay, slide back up. These are the managers. Who are the managers? Trustees, trustee, manager. Manager. See, go back down. Trustee, manager. That's the problem. What's the problem? Okay, these people. This is who the trustees and managers are concerned about. They're not worried about Moors. Why do I say that? Because they've already signed contracts with the Moorish government. The bankers already know the contractual obligations to Moors. The managers know the contractual obligations to Moors. But what the problem is that the bankers and the managers haven't told the Americans the real history that they didn't get these so-called black people from Africa. That these so-called black people was already here and the land is Morocco and these are Moroccans that they keep calling black. They don't want to tell these people that the Moors are the true landlords of the land. Because they're afraid that these people are going to storm the capital again and say, you lied to us, so we're going to have you on the run. Because these people already know that the bankers are running everything. They know it. They know it. And they're sick and tired of being sick and tired. Because the middle class is shrinking. So now they're chasing their own people. Huh? You know what that looked like? Rosa Parks trying to get a slave out of the plantation. They on the run, ain't they? And guess who on their butts? The hounds. Look at them hounds. Them hounds on their butts. Oh, they don't like it. They don't like it when it's happening to them. This is how my people have felt for decades, running for their lives. And the whole problem is this, right here. This is the problem, Moors. The problem is not Moors. The problem is this dude, and this dude knows that they have to respect this dude. And this dude got to respect the Brentwood International Bankers. The bankers run the whole show. But wait a minute. Who controls the bankers? Okay. Now you go to the Act of Sarah's of 1906. That the ICJ was talking about in 1952. Mm-hmm. Who gets to have full jurisdiction? Who gets to have limited jurisdiction? The United States wants full jurisdiction. Why? So they can control Moors. That way the bankers can control everything else, because the Act of Sarah's goes back up to now Article 3. Chapter 3, I should say. Chapter 3 says an act of concessions for a Moroccan state bank. They know the Moors can enact a Moroccan state bank to control the narrative of the empire, which makes the IMF subjugated and inferior to a national Moroccan bank. The Federal Reserve is inferior to a Moroccan national bank. Bretton Woods International Bank is inferior to Moroccan Moors banks. So the United States the whole time and its international bankers have been trying to get the Moors, M-O-R, Moroccans, Moors, from establishing their banks, because the Moors will control the narrative. Of what? Wars. See, the Moors had an obligation to what? Demilitarize. The bankers make most of their money off of what? Military arms. These two things can't exist at the same time. You must understand what's happening, Moors. Joe Biden is not necessarily the problem. Joe Biden is not the problem. It's this dude. Don't get me wrong, Joe Biden has obligations. Because he knows that the United States of America, as the de jure name on the contract, is obligated to the Moroccan treaties. So therefore the bankers, who call themselves Americans, and the representatives who call themselves Americans, are obligated to the Moroccan treaties and international law. And that's the problem. And they don't want to admit it. Because they're scared of who? These people. Well, guess what? Unfortunately, the clocks of destiny are here, because this was just a small sample of it. It's clocks of destiny. It's already happening. The Americans are fighting back. And I got a message for the Americans. The Moroccan states can help the Americans to reestablish the republic for which it stood, but it does not stand today. Because the United States of America has been sold out by the bankers, the judges, and the legislators. And these people know it. And now they're trying to get the republic back. It's shameful what's happened to the Americans, and it's shameful what's happened to the Moroccans because of the trustees, and the managers who've been overseeing the trust territory, commonly known as the Empire of Morocco. All right, so as I start to close out, we were reading over Section 24 of the United States of America's Declaration of Intervention that started talking about this word in part, so I have to go deeper for the Moors to understand that, because the Moors are not interested in Ukraine versus Russia. The Moors are interested in finding out how do we bring a suit of genocide, right? But first we have to go back and understand a little bit of history of what has taken place since 1952. 1952 set off a chain reaction that caused the United States to panic. The United States found out they couldn't hold on to the Moors Empire in full. They could only hold on to the Moors Empire from a limited perspective. So then they get into a conspiracy with Mohammed V to help Mohammed V to get away from France. Mohammed V signs the Franco-Morocco Agreement in 1956, March 2nd, 1956. And immediately, the United States of America is like, aha, now we got a way to undermine the Moors. That way, the United States of America will get full jurisdiction instead of limited jurisdiction. The only way they can have full jurisdiction is the Moors didn't exist on paper. So they needed the Sultan's help before the Sultan enacted his constitution of 1962. So it's a lot that took place between 1952 and 1962. You got to catch what's happening. All right? So as we continue to reading Moors, just to let you know, the next paragraph, okay, is section 25. Section 25 starts to get in to what's called genocide, okay? Genocide and the word aggression, okay? Genocide and the word aggression is what the United States is about to start talking about, okay? Listen to me. The United States now is now bringing these two words together in one sentence. Listen. It says the Genocide Convention does not authorize a contracting party to commit aggression against another contracting party on the pretext of preventing a punishing genocide, right? So what's my point? We're getting ready to start learning about the word genocide and aggression. How does the United States use verbiage to bring these two words together, right? They're bringing these two words together. Okay, now we go back to the charter. Had the same way I opened up, I said, okay, now we're getting ready to get to what? Chapter 7 of the Charter of the United Nations, and Chapter 7 is about acts of aggression. See how I'm tying these things together? Okay? So, all right. Let's take it to the board as I start to close out. Okay, what do I have up here? Okay. Charter of the United Nations, Chapter 7. Articles 39 through 51 is what we're about to enter into. It's about an action with respect to threats to the peace, breaches of the peace, and acts of aggression. All right, so I got a drop-down box. We'll get into this in class 108. All right, so the drop-down box is about what? Acts of aggression and acts of genocide and acts of colonialism and acts of extraterritorial jurisdiction is what you consider crimes against humanity. Okay? So now that we're in chapter 7, we're entering to chapter 7. Chapter 7 is about aggression. Okay? And aggression is also synonymous with genocide, colonialism, and extraterritorial jurisdiction. We're going to learn about that in class 108. All right, so as we start closing out now, we're going to now finally get into chapter 7. And at the same time, we're going to keep reading about the United States. It's now going to teach us about how to add the word genocide and aggression into your dispute through consular court. All right? Mm-hmm. I am with that.
Islam.
Islam.